We are looking at let us see solutions. This is chapter 5, the functions and the pointers. Simple functions passing values between functions. What will be the output of these program? First of all, this main, we have a printf here and this is a display. Now display is calling this main again. Display is calling main again. So main control will go here. From display, the control will go to this display function. Then again, the control will go back to main and this will go on and on. So these two lines will be printed indefinitely. Infinite loop will be there. It's not loop, basically. They will be printed indefinitely. Then again, the same situation arises here. Main is calling itself. Main is calling itself. So it will be round and round and round. So this message will be printed indefinitely. We have I equal to 45 and we want to send this I here, and then we want to check something. Whatever check is there, we see if I just say that, okay, this is an operator, we'll talk about that later. Let us assume it is just greater than equal to, just assume this. So we'll get 100 here. This will be the simply output, because 45, when we have a value which we are passing, 45 is greater than or equal to 45. I'm just ignoring this because we'll talk about this operator later. 45 is actually is equal to 45, so 100 will come. Next is 45. We are sending it to multiply I into 1000 and we are trying to evaluate some value with respect to this function. But the problem here is there is a multiply function which we have called, but there is no definition of multiply. In fact, we have some check here. So there will be a problem because function multiply is not defined. We have to find out the error. We are sending 3 and 4 in this function addMult. And now we are trying to print this K and L as you see here. We are trying to find out II and JJ. Everything is fine up till this line. We cannot return two values. We can only return one value in C. If you want to return more than one value, then you have to use the pointers. So the function cannot return two values or more than one value at a time. This is A. This message has been assigned to A. But this message is showing something and it is not returning anything. When it is not returning anything, you cannot assign it to A. So the error is nothing because there is no syntax error. But since we don't have any value being returned, there is no need to collect A. I am again implying that this program has no problem. The only situation here is when it is not returning anything, there is no return. Why are you assigning it to A? Next is A is 15.5, character is 6. You are passing 15.5 and C here. Now you are trying to print this A and CH. So what will be printed? Now the thing is, A and CH, they are not being given any data type here. Whenever you are defining or function definition is there, you need to give the type here. This is the situation. Now we have main. You are having two messages. So first this will be called, then again this will be called. So what will be the situation? The situation is this semicolon. Whenever we give a function definition, we don't put any semicolon. So the error is a semicolon here. This main, let us see. Now the problem here is you cannot have a function definition inside a function definition in C. This is not allowed. So one function cannot be defined within another function. You have to take it out here and now you can define. Answer the following. Is this a correctly written function? This is all good, but this semicolon, when you are defining a function, you don't put a semicolon. And in fact, this way of defining means making A an integer A, you are defining it or declaring it here. This is K and R method. K and R method, Cunningham-Ricci method. State whether the following statements are true or false. The variable commonly used in C functions are available to all functions in a program. So the variables which are used in C functions are available to all functions in a program. This is absolutely wrong. There is a scope of every variable. If it is inside some block, it is not available outside the block. If it is inside some function, it is not available outside the function. That is why we have global variables for that. So this is false. To return the control back to the colleague function, we must use the keyword return. This is also not true, because even if you don't have return, you can still return the control back to the calling function. The same variable names can be used in different functions without any conflict. This is absolutely correct, because when you are having different functions, that means the scope is different. When the scope is different, the variables, even if you name them similar, they don't conflict. They don't have any conflict between them. Every call function must contain a return statement. No, if you want a function just to print some value, why would you return? Why would you need some return? So this is false. A function may contain more than one return statement. Yes, absolutely right. You can have multiple return statement, but only one is going to work. Every return statement in a function may return a different value. This is absolutely true. That is why you have multiple returns to return multiple type of value. A function can still be useful even if you don't pass any arguments to it and the function doesn't return any value back. See, this is true. If it doesn't, if you don't even pass any number or parameter and you don't want any return, the function can still do a needful or help, you know, a substantial work. So don't judge a function by the return values or the parameters being passed. Even if you don't have both of these, this function can be useful to you. Answer the following. Write a function to calculate the factorial value of any integer entered through the keyboard. So we need to write a factorial, calculate factorial of a function, of an integer using a function. So this is how we include the files. Then we give a fact. This is a function. We are going to define this function. Here we are only declaring it. Then we are taking the number from the user in num. Enter a number in num. Now we'll pass this value to this factorial and the result will be taken here and this will be printed. As you see here, this we will print. So let us concentrate to this function. So we are passing some num value. We start with factorial equal to 1. Every time from 1 to this number, factorial will be factorial into I and we will return the factorial. You know the logic of this by now. We have discussed it in stretch. Write a power function, this PAB, to calculate the value of A raised to the power B. Say some 3 to the power 2 or 2 to the power 3. This function you have to write. So let us write a program to calculate the power of a value. So what we do, we include the files. We say, we give the prototype of a function. And then we accept the value x and y. This is x, this is y. Here this is x, this is y. Now we just call this function power and pass the values x and y. We are passing the values here. And now we are trying to print out the values which are being returned by this power. So this is x, this is y. Now this goes from 1 to y. What we are trying to do here is p is equal to p into x. We have taken say x as 2 and y as 3. So we want to find 2 to the power 3. What is happening here is initially p is 1. So first of all it goes from 1 to y. That is it will go from 1 to 3. This is x, this is y. So it will go from 1 to 3. And this is p equal to p into x. In the first case p is 1. So this will be 1 into what is x? We have taken x as 2. So initially p will be 2, 1 into 2. Now 1 will be incremented to 2. 2. Now again x, this same will be done. So p will be equal to, now p is now this one, 1 into 2. And then again we have this x. So 1 x will all this x. P, this is p and this is x. Now this again I will be incremented, so it will be 3. So it will again run. Now p has a value 1 into 2 into 2. And now we have to multiply x also, that is 2. So 2 will be multiplied 3. This is 2 to the power 3 and this is the return value which will be printed here. Write a general purpose function to convert any given year into Roman equivalent. These are the table showing the Roman equivalent of decimal number. See, this 1988 I can write as what? 1988 I can write as say 1000 plus 500 plus 4 into 100 plus 50 plus we have 30, so 3 into 10 you can say, plus now we have 35, and then we have 8, so this will be 38. This number is exactly like this. Why have I written like this? Because I have some Roman numbers which are related to these decimal values. So this is what M, I have taken it from here. 500 is what? D. So this will be D. 4 into 100 is what? 4 times 100. So this is 100, so we'll write C 4 times. C, 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 C. This is 50. 50 we have as L. 3 into 10. So we write this 10 thrice. X, X, X. X, X, X. What is this 8? 8 can be written as V. This is 5. And now 8 can be written as 5 plus 3. Okay. So for 5 we write V, and for 3, we don't have anything for 3, so we write 1, 1, 1, 3 times. So, I. So, this is how we write 1988. I hope you got the idea. Now, let us take one more, 1525. 1525 can be written like this. We can write 1525 as, say, 1000 plus we have the second one, that is 500. Then we have 20, so let us make it as 2 into 10. Then we have 5. So 5 is there, so we write 5. This 1000 will be what? M. This will be what? D. This will be what? 2 into 10. So X. And this 5 can be written as V. See, this is our value. So we have to write a program for this. So how to convert? First of all, we'll enter the year. This year will be taken here. Let us take an example of 1525. I'll just give you a glimpse so that you understand how these things are going on. 1525. So we enter, first of all, this romanized function. This romanized function is there. First of all, y will be what? This year. So it will be 1525. First of all. Then k will be what? 1000. So this will be 1000. The character is m. So m will go. Since y is not 9, 1525 is 9. We will not go inside this. Y is not 4. We don't go inside this. Then we come here. J is equal to y by k. J is equal to y by k. So J will be what? Y by k. 1525 by 1000. This gives you 1. And this loop goes from 1 to J. That is, it will go from 1 to 1. And character will be printed. So character will be printed. What is the character? This is M. So first of all, M will be printed. Then we return y minus k into j, and this will be taken in yr. Y minus k into j is what? Y, this is, y is what? Our 1525. This is minus, what is k? K is 1000. What is j? J is 1 here. So into 1. So what will be into 1? What will be returned? 1525 minus 1000, 525. 525 will be returned here. 525. So now this function call is over. Now we have year as 525 because this year will use. Now again 525, 500 and D will go. So now the entries will be 525. The K will be 500. And the character, you can say alphabet, can be D, will be D. Now again this is Y is not 9, it is not 4. So we come directly here. So J will be what? 525 by 500. You again get 1 because when you divide, you get 1. Again, you run it for one time, so character will be D. So D will be printed here. Then next time, what will be returned? Y minus K into J. So 525 minus 500 into 1. So 25. So now 25 will go. 25, 100 and C. And likewise, the things will go on. Okay, I hope you got the idea. That is how you get 1525 MDXXV. We have got the MD. I hope you will be able to find out how we can get this XXV. So this is how this function goes. And this is simply, if you get 9, you write IX. Because for 9, for 9 and 4, we have these symbols, IV. 1 is 1, 2 is 2, 3 is 3. The thing changes at 4. So, this 4 has to be treated separately. Then we have 5. This already we have. Here we have 5. See. Then 6. We know 5 plus 1 we can write. 7. This is 5, 6. 7 is VII. So, we can write this also. And then we have 8, VIII. There is no problem. But when we come to 9, this is IX. So, we have to separately take the case of 9, IX. That is why we have taken separately 4 and 9. Because once it comes to 10, then we already have 10. That is 4 and 9 has been taken. So, when it comes to 9 or 10, this will be taken care. This will be the result. And yet, we have to print IX and IV. Any year is entered through the keyboard, write a function to determine whether the year is a leap year or not. A leap year is that year which comes every 4 years, because the earth revolves around the sun, and this is around 365 days we take, but it is not 365, basically it is 365.25, or if I can make more, this is 365.2422, like this. So when this 25 means 1/4 of a day. So after 4 years, this 0.25, 0.25, 0.25, 0.25, this becomes 1. So now after 4 years, the year has 366 days. So in February, you get 29 days rather than 28. So how to check for a leap year? The leap year can be checked like this. If it is divisible by 4, and a number is divisible by 4 and it is not divisible by 100, then it is a leap year. Or if a number is divisible or an year is divisible by 100, which is 400, then it is a leap year. This is the thing which we are going to use. So we will write a function. These include we do year. Now enter the year. We'll take the year in ampersand year and we'll pass it to the function. Even if you don't pass to the function, then this also works, because we can write those content, the statement here itself. So now we get the leap year and we'll just come out. So let us concentrate on this leap year. The leap year function has simple logic. If the year which is being entered, if it is divisible by 4, that is modulo is 0, equal to 0, and this has to be true together. And the modulo of 100, it is not divisible by 0. It should not be divisible by 4. As I said, the year should be divisible by 4 if it is 0. And if it is 0, it should not be divisible by 100. So this is modulo. It should not be 0. Or this is one condition. The other condition is the year is properly divisible by 400. So why modulo 400 equal to 0? So these are two separate conditions. If these two conditions are met, this or this, the year is leap year. Otherwise, we say the year is not a leap year. A positive integer is entered through the keyboard. Write a function to obtain the prime factors of this number. The prime factors of 24 are what? 2, 2, 2, 4, 2, 2, 2, 3. 35 also 5 and 7. Let me give you an example of 24 so that we'll use it there. What we do? We start with 2. So, in the program also, we'll start with 2. We divide this 24 to 12 is 24. Then, we'll use 12. Next time, we use 12. We divide again by 2. This is 2, 6 is 12. Now, again, we try to divide by 2. This is 2, 3 is 6. Now, again, we try to divide by 2, but it is not divisible by 2. Right? So, we have to use the next number. That is 2. After 2, it is 3. So, 3, 1 is 3. And we stop at 1. This is the logic. We start with 2. Every time we take the next number. And we go up to, and we increment this number. If it is not divisible by 2, we go to 3. And we stop at 1. So we have to obtain the prime factors of a number. This is stdio.h, conio.h. We take a number, we enter the number, and we pass this number to this function which is called prime. And we just, in this prime, we'll print that number. Print all these numbers which are the prime factors of any number. So what is the logic of this? As we said, we'll start with 2. So we start I with 2 and we'll print the factors here. every time this will be printed. So while the number is not equal to 1, as I just said, we have to go up till 1. We have to go up till 1. So we'll check here. If number is not equal to 1, then we go, then only we move forward. We divide or we take the modulo of number with I, with 2. If it is equal to 0, we just print I. That is, if it is dividing 24, we get a 12, and the remainder becomes 0, we print this 2. That is how we are printing 2. Otherwise, if it is not printing, we will go on and on, because this will be true for next 2 also. 2 6 are 12, 2 3 are 6. It goes like this. Now next time, it is not divisible by 0. So we have to take the next one. So we are increasing else. We have to go in else. We are incrementing it by 1. So we are incrementing 2 by 3. And now we are continuing. Because we are incrementing and we are continuing, that is, we don't want to place any value here. We don't want to continue. Because we want to go again for the, just to check whether we get 1 or not. And every time we have to give this number as num equal to num by I. See, this 24 is num. Next time it will be num equal to num by I. So we divide 24 by 2, we get 12. So next time we will go for 12. We will search, or we will do it for 12, not for 24. Next time again we go for 6, not for 12. This is how the logic goes. Function prototypes, call by value, reference, pointers. What will be the output of the program? This program. See, we are passing 1. And we are trying to find out this circle, the area of circle, so 3.14 into 1 into 1. So you should get 3.14, you return 3.14, so it will be printed. But the question here is 3.14 will not be printed. The result will be 3.000000. Why? Because this circle has no return type. And if you don't give any return type, the C is going to take it as integer. When it is integer, this 3.14, 0.14 will be truncated. That is why we use C3. That is why we get the output as 3. Next is, this is slogan. Then we pass C, this we have C equal to 5, and we are trying to assign this slogan to C. And see, we have no return type here because we have a void. How can you assign some void to C? There will be an error message. There has to be some return so that you can assign it to some variable. Answer the following question. Write a function which receives a float and integer. Find the product of these two and return the product which is printed through main. So just find the product of float and integer. We'll try to write a program. This is x. We take float as y and prod product. We write a function prototype. This is a product function. We are passing an integer and a float, and the return type will be float. So we ask the user to input the float value and integer value. One we will take in percent %f, other we will take in percent %d. This is the product function. This is the product function, and this will be printed all, and we just come out. But before that, we have to see this function, what it does. This is int x, this is float y. What is happening here is, we are passing x, we are passing y. So we are passing some values, which is one is integer, one is float. And we have specifically given that the return type should be float. So this is how it will be returned. Write a function which receives 5 integers and return the sum, average and standard deviation of these numbers. We call this function from main and print the result in main. So we have to find this sum, average and standard deviation. Sum is simply adding the number. Average is adding them and dividing by the number of the content or number of the candidate values, and this is the standard deviation. Standard deviation is simply take this value, every value, subtract it from the average, square it and add them all, and then take a square root. This is how we'll do. So this is sum average, double we take standard deviation, we pass this to sum average and stdvv. Why? Because we want the change to be seen here, and we print these numbers, these values actually, and we'll print them and we come out. So we have to concentrate on this function, how it works. So we are passing, because the address are being passed, address of sum. So we have to have a pointer here. Similarly for average and similarly for the standard deviation. Now we are taking four values. We are asking for five values. Sorry. So we are asking for five values. We are taking the five values in 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, n, 1 to 5. We are adding them and now we are assigning them to star sum. That is, star sum is what? Sum is actually the address. So we want the value at this address. So this will be added and provided to star sum. And this star sum can be read directly and divided by 5. This will give you the average. When you want to find out the standard deviation, just take the square root. For that we took square SQRT. Then we took every value, subtracted it from the average and power it with 2. So each entry, this is power function. So this is simply N1 minus AVG, star AVG means value at AVG square. This is what we have done. And we have added all of them, 5 of them, and taken the square root. And this is how standard deviation will be computed. So this is the first part of our discussion on question and answer. We'll be taking one more. Till then, thank you so much. Take care of yourself.